That's harder than it sounds, actually. Is digital history just history using a new batch of tools? So, or is it something that actually suggests a new way of thinking about history? And I mean, in construction, if you got a new batch of tools, you wouldn't necessarily start talking about a new kind of construction. It's just construction with new tools. So that when you get out and you start looking at what different people are doing and calling it digital history, there is in fact that dichotomy. I think there are people who are just doing the same things that have always been done, but maybe with better illustrations or better more sophisticated handling of numbers. And then there's also people who are actually thinking, well, if I've got the enormous computing power, which is really what we're talking about, then that lets me ask all sorts of different questions that I couldn't possibly ever have asked before. So that's sort of a, I would like to think that I'm in the camp that uses digital history to ask different questions that were impossible to ask or even think about even 5 years ago. But I'm probably guilty of just putting dots on a map every once in a while and calling it a fabulous new insight from time to time. But well, I'm an archaeologist. I like to think of myself as an archaeologist, and how I got into digital history was at the start of my PhD work, when I was presented with a collection of material, stamped Roman bricks, and told to work on that. I could be part of the project if I analyzed this material. And the way that that material had been analyzed in the past, really, I couldn't really contribute anything new in that case other than simply producing a catalog of what I had. And it was when I realized that the material I had let me start looking at social networks and to actually start looking at how people were connected and then to start to reanimate that, that I started becoming a digital historian. And it was the only way I could keep from going insane during my PhD work, was to start using the power of a computer to find the patterns and the connections that were in my material that I could have worked out on paper and I could have drawn them out, but it would have taken so much longer. And then the actual ability to, using agent modeling, to start running simulations with those patterns as a starting point and seeing what emerged out of that, that really got me excited about it. I've been fortunate in that the people that I've worked with have always given me my head and said, okay, run with that, see what happens, go with that. And I think archaeology has always been quite willing to embrace new approaches, to always try and get at that, trying to extract new information and new ways of thinking about our human past and human culture and history through material culture. And it's it has actually been quite an open experience, and people have been willing to give me the benefit of the doubt sometimes and to see what it is that I'm doing. And what's really fun for me is when I do get talking to people and the things that I'm doing inspire them to go off and try something new with their own material that they hadn't thought of doing before. And then, of course, you always do run into people who don't buy it. And, you know, and that's valid too, because it's the onus is on me to demonstrate that what I'm doing is valid, is grounded, is pushing knowledge further and not just creating pretty PowerPoints. In some of my teaching, I like to use commercial video games, Civilization 4, for instance. And I built a little scenario in that. I was having trouble with, in my class, with this kind of reasoning that says, well, Vespasian wins the Civil War in 69 because he was going to be a great emperor, so of course he won the Civil War, so this circular kind of reasoning. So in Civ 4, I built a scenario to play for just covering 5 or 6 years of that period around AD 69. And the students play as the different pretenders to the throne. And it becomes quickly evident that it could have gone either way. How things happened isn't necessarily how things had to happen. It wasn't preordained. And that little scenario, I put it on one of the fan sites. And it's only been on there for just 2 or 3 months now. And 5,000 people have taken a look at that. And I know my PhD thesis isn't going to be read by 5,000 people. So the digital work, and some of my more academic simulations have had more impact than any of my papers that I've written or anything like that. And it has been in an audience that isn't necessarily a traditional academic audience. I think there might be interesting applications in things like data mining and information theory and the sorts of work that goes on right now in big corporations who want to understand their customer databases better, and the sorts of tools and techniques that they use transfer those approaches into historical databases. Some of the historical databases that we've seen today have been absolutely amazing with the amount and the detail and the quality information that's in there. So I think there could be really interesting overlaps or applications there. And agent modeling, I think, is an interesting an area that, it's the area that I'm working in a lot right now, but I'm working on it because I've got very specific questions that I'm trying to answer. So trying to imagine how a proper historian would use that. But just the opportunity to see how different layers of organization and complexity in the world emerge out of one another and interact with one another. And when you would run an agent simulation from a historic starting point, you set all the levers and pulleys and everything in a way to represent, I don't know, the English rail network in 1845, and then set it loose and see what happens, and then comparing that back with the one actual true history that did run, if you can talk about true history, and using agent modeling to clarify how we think things work, and using it to expose our biases and our assumptions, and using it to invite other people to redo the analysis, but from their own perspective, can really enrich the whole process of doing history, of communicating history, and of creating a historical mindset in the wider population.